Welcome to these videos that I'm recording for you from Hendaye, France. My name's Kurt DeBerg, and hello, wherever in the world you are. If you're looking at this video, you're likely a very much big fan of Ernest Hemingway, or you're about to be, I hope. The purpose of these videos, really, there's three of them. First, I'd like to shed some light on a particular time in Ernest's life. I'd also like to read passages from his books and his letters about this time period. Now notice this picture here is from the volume 1929 to 1931, and I will take the liberty to read very brief passages as it relates to Ernest's time and the period of his life that I'm talking about, but I won't take over use of literary license here because I know this is copyrighted by the Hemingway Society. The third reason is I'd like to introduce readers to my perspective on Hemingway, which includes excerpts from my forthcoming book, along with photos that I've taken as I've traveled in Hemingway's footsteps over the past 3 years. Now, this first episode begins in Hendaye, France, because that's where I happen to be right now. I have moved to Hendaye permanently, or at least on a semi-permanent basis, because my copine and I have a second apartment near Paris, and we have an apartment here in Hendaye as well. This first video will focus on Ernest's time here in 1929, and he had been here twice before, once in 1925, and he came back again in 1927. And by coming back in 1929, we can see that he has a special place in his heart for Hendaye. Now, who am I? Well, this is a picture of me a year or two ago when I was in Harry's Bar in Paris at Rue Danou. And it's a famous Hemingway spot for more than one reason. I retired from a university in California in 2020. I was a business professor. My home base, as I said, is now in Hendaye, although our second home is in near the heart of Paris. It's a 25-minute train ride to a little suburb called Saint-Maur-des-Fosses. Hemingway is a passion of mine, and of course I read a little bit of Hemingway's work, The Old Man and the Sea, and a couple other books while I was in high school, but I really discovered him 25 years ago when I was in Key West. And then I've become enamored with him, in fact, enraptured with his life story and his literature starting in 2016. Who am I? Well, I'm told you I was a professor, but I also have a very soft spot in my heart for my twin granddaughters. This would be Sky, and that's Isla. And they're almost going to be 7 years old here in February, but they live in Glasgow, Scotland. These are my favorite sassy little lassies. Okay, Hendaye, 1929. Welcome, everybody. Hendaye, as you can see here, this ocean part here, that's part of the Atlantic Ocean. But this part of the Atlantic is known as the Bay of Biscay. And I'll show this on a little larger map in a moment. But you can see Hendaye is right here. And if you look really closely, there's a that little black line is the line between France here and Spain. And of course, with Spain, you might know San Sebastian as a famous Hemingway location, but you all are probably familiar with Pamplona. So you can go 1 hour straight south of Hendaye on train and be in the famous city of Pamplona where the bulls run and the wine flows. Hemingway returned here in 1929 to Hendaye. It's not Hendaye, but it's Hendaye. And he was excited to be returning to Europe, not so much because of Paris, but rather it was Pamplona and the beaches that he was mainly interested in during the summer. And in the winter, he wanted to go back to the slopes of Switzerland with his new friends, the Murphys and the Fitzgeralds and the MacLeishes and the Dos Passos. Well, there's only one John Dos Passos at that time. He was single. Where is Hendaye? Well, let's take another look. Here's a map of France, and Hendaye, I said, was very much right there in the tiny corner of the southwest part of France. Here's the Bay of Biscay, and of course the Atlantic Ocean is over here. But Hendaye runs, the coast runs east and west here for a ways, and it's kind of funny for me to be looking out of my apartment. I'm looking almost straight north, although if I look west, the sun would be setting over there toward America. But here's Bayonne, here's San Sebastian, Bordeaux, the famous red wine. Ernest spent some time here in the French Riviera back in 1926 when he was messing around with Pauline while still married to Hadley. He was injured over here near Venice in a little town called Fasolta, right here. And he spent some time in the hospital in Milan. He started writing the short story Cat in the Rain in Rapallo. So, good map of Hemingway right there. And then, of course, here's a map where we focus not on France, but here's Spain. And, of course, in this corner, you see San Sebastian and Pamplona are in the north central part of Spain, with San Sebastian being part of the on the border of the Bay of Biscay. I hope that puts things in better perspective for you. I can do that much better with a video rather than my podcast that I started broadcasting last week. Well, setting the stage for 1929, we really need to look back and see what happened in 1928. And it was a huge year for Ernest. He and his second wife are adjusting to life as a married couple in 1928. Pauline had gotten pregnant in late 1927, and the baby was born in the middle of 1928. So the newlyweds were looking forward to the birth of their first baby, which turned out to be a son, Patrick. Having alienated so many of his friends with the publication of his salacious first big novel called The Sun Also Rises in 1926, Ernest and Pauline had gone back to America at the in the spring of 1928 with an eye toward a permanent settlement there. And they were going to keep an eye out to move somewhere away from Paris and away from the roaring 20s. They also wanted their baby to be born in America, possibly with Ernest's father, Dr. Clarence N. Hemingway, performing the delivery. And Ernest was talking to him, hoping he might deliver the baby in Oak Park, Ernest's childhood home, or maybe up in Petoskey, Michigan, where the family would vacation for 3 months every summer. And I don't mean once in a while or frequently. Ernest never missed a summer until he was 19 and or 18 and had to go to Europe as a Red Cross volunteer. Shortly before departing in March of 1928, Ernest was injured when the famous bathroom skylight incident occurred. The skylight had come crashing down on his head at his apartment at 6 Rue Férou. That happened on March 4, 1928. Ada McLeish, Ernest's friend, was called by Pauline, and he came over and rushed Hemingway to the hospital. And the accident caused the famous gaping wound in his forehead, and you can see that right there in that picture in 1928. It's a fresh wound. That wound never healed well, and you can see that scar in all the non-airbrush photos of Hemingway taken after March of 1928. The good news is, Pauline said that if him having an injury that would draw blood like this is what it took to get him out of writer's block, well then maybe they should bleed him more often. Because right after that March 4 event, Ernest began writing A Farewell to Arms. And keep this in mind, he now had a first-hand view and feeling of what it meant to have a concussion and what it meant to have a real shot to the head with a head laceration. Because he gave these same injuries to Frederick Henry in the book A Farewell to Arms, which he had just begun writing after the skylight incident. Well, after Ernest and Pauline had landed in Key West for a couple months in early and mid-1928, they set off for Kansas City, where in June, on June 28, baby Patrick was born. He was a 9-pound healthy baby boy. The bad news is Pauline endured an excruciatingly painful childbirth, and ultimately Patrick was delivered by a cesarean section, with Ernest looking on to his horror. And this incident left such an indelible impression on him that the episode helped him craft the unforgettable ending to A Farewell to Arms. Now, Dr. Hemingway, look at how much he looked like Ernest. If you look at him from the nose up, that could be a spitting image of Ernest. And even the hairline, the dark, dark beard, not so much, because Ernest really wore a mustache in his early part of his life and grew the beard later to protect his son from, or his face from the sun. When he began fishing long days in the Gulf Stream, he had a tendency to get a bad sunburn. Well, as Ernest was busy writing A Farewell to Arms during the summer of 1928 in the Bighorn Mountains of Wyoming, he also wrote a little bit of this in Piggott, Arkansas, Pauline's parents' home. At that time, Dr. Hemingway was falling into greater and greater despair. It all came to a head on December 6, 1928, when he ultimately, in his bedroom, took out, it was his father's Civil War revolver, and he put it to his temple and he shot himself. And this occurred on the third floor of Ernest's boyhood home in Oak Park, Illinois. Now, as the oldest male in a family with 6 children, Ernest was now the head of household. He now had to worry about how to take care of his mother, Grace, and his 2 youngest siblings who were still living at home, Carol, and at the time, Lester was age 14. In spite of the trauma and the horrific death of his father, Ernest had a lot to be happy with. He had serialized the rights to sell installments of A Farewell to Arms to Scribner's magazine, and he pushed that up in negotiations with Scribner's to $16,000. That was just for the serial rights to the book, and that's worth about $250,000 in today's denomination if you were to roll this forward for inflation. So he signed the deal for the advance. The baby was doing well, and he and Pauline boarded the ship, and off they went to Paris. And there's baby Patrick on his knee, not yet a year old. And it had been a big year in 28. Ernest had been in Key West, Kansas City, Piggott, Arkansas, Wyoming, Montana, Key West. Now they're back to Europe. They were road warriors, to be sure. They set sail in April of 1929, and they arrived in Paris in late April. I think it was April, let me look at my notes here. It was April 22 when they landed in Paris. And when I say landed, they arrived. They took the ship for a couple weeks, and then they took a train from Boulogne on the coast of France to Paris. Now, Ernest longed to come back to Hendaye, and that's where Hendaye comes in, because in the first 10 days or so of May, Ernest returned to Hendaye by himself, not with Pauline. She was fighting off an illness, and she just wasn't feeling well. So Ernest came here to rewrite and rewrite again the ending to the book that was to come out in September of A Farewell to Arms. It was excruciating. Let's take a look at 2 of the last passages. It's phenomenal writing here. Near the end of the book, he says, "It seems she had one hemorrhage after another. They couldn't stop it. I went into the room and stayed with Catherine until she died. She was unconscious all the time, and it did not take her very long to die." On the next page, and the very end of the book, he says, "But after I got them to leave and shut the door and turned off the light, it wasn't any good. It was like saying goodbye to a statue. And after a while, I went out and left the hospital, and I walked back to the hotel in the rain." All I can say is, wow. That's Hemingway at his best, at what is arguably his best novel. Here's some pictures of Hemingway. Here he's on the beach in Hendaye. This picture is with him on the beach in San Sebastian, just 15 miles straight west of here. And here he is with a group of friends in Hendaye. It's either 1929, this might be 1931, I'm not sure. But this is his attorney, Spicer. I forget his first name. I think it's Martin Spicer. And here's a very well-known French, I think he was a writer or an artist. But Ernest was then hanging around some important, I think his name was Morton Spicer. Last name was Spicer in any case. And he's, Ernest is proudly posing here. And look, again, you can see how much he looked like his father from the nose up, and even with the dark mustache. Turning the channel a bit, what about Hendaye today? I took this picture just a few days ago from the pier where the river starts and dips into the ocean. And this is the Bay of Biscay. I'm looking at Hendaye. If I turned around, I would be overlooking the channel where the river flows into the ocean, and I would be looking at the Spanish town of Hondarribia. Hendaye is 16,000 people. It's part of the famous Basque country here. It's known for its own language, culture, customs, and I might add wine and food. It has a working harbor with a port that is home to sailboats, small yachts, and even working fishing boats. You can take a 10-minute boat taxi and be in Spain. I walk there frequently. I take a 3-euro ride and I'm in Spain, and 15 minutes later I'm sitting at a cafe sipping Rioja wine and eating these wonderful Spanish tapas. Actually, I'll let you read it. I'll read now. The two young people in the car rode down the boulevard, slowly looking out at the magnificent beach and at the mountains of Spain that showed blue in this light as the car passed the casino and the big hotel and went on toward the end of the boulevard. Ahead was the mouth of the river that flowed into the ocean. The tide was out, and across the bright sand they saw the ancient Spanish town and the green hills across the bay, and at the far point, the lighthouse. They stopped the car. "It's a lovely place," the girl said. "There's a cafe with tables under the trees," the young man said. "Old trees." Well, it's unfortunate that Ernest didn't take that manuscript for the Garden of Eden to press, because it was still in working form when he killed himself in 1961, and the Garden of Eden was published posthumously. Now, in one of the letters Hemingway wrote in 1929, he wrote a letter on March 1, 1929, shortly before he and Pauline set sail for Europe. And Ernest wrote his mentor, a gentleman named Owen Wister. And he had met Wister in the summer of 1928 when he and Pauline were making their way from Sheridan, Wyoming, out to Cook City, Montana. And they stopped in Wister's town of Shell, Wyoming. And they took a great liking to each other, and I think it's fair to say that Hemingway stood in awe of the great writer of the famous Western novel called The Virginian. But in this letter he wrote Wister, he says the following: "If your damaged goods about taking care of the human machine, let me be as damaged as you are at 68 and I'll be happy. In 1919, I had, still have, an aluminum kneecap. Bad heart, fine now. Hole in throat about 2 inches deep. all right now, but have to watch it. Also, after effects of concussion of brain, couldn't sleep, etc. All right now. Various other minor infirmities. Now I'm in good shape, but don't look forward to expect a long life. Burn too much too early. That last sentence, how clairvoyant is that? Man, he's foreshadowing something that ended up happening. He says he's in good shape, but he doesn't expect to live long. He's burned up too much. Well, let's dissect the rest of this. He never had an aluminum kneecap. That was proven false, but oftentimes later in life, after he would spin these big yarns, he would tell people that he was wounded by a machine gun fire in World War I and that he needed a knee replacement, a kneecap replacement. Well, A, he wasn't wounded by machine guns, it was shrapnel, and B, he never needed an aluminum kneecap. In fact, the shrapnel never even hit bone. The fragment hit behind his patella without hitting bone. So this is false, and I've got documented proof of this. What about the bad heart? Nope. There was no evidence ever that I can find that Hemingway suffered from anything like heart murmur or arrhythmia or anything like this. Of course, in the mid-50s, he was diagnosed with hypertension, and he was treated for hypertension then. And when he was admitted to the Mayo Clinic in December of at the end of November, early December of 1960, the reason they admitted him publicly was for hypertension. And of course, he had hypertension, but the real reason was he was having psychological problems. What about the hole in throat? Answer, not true as a result of his 1919 or 1918 injuries. He had a hole in the throat from when he was a little boy, when he was walking with he was carrying milk in a bucket and a sharp stick in his other hand, and he tripped and fell, and the stick gouged his throat, and it was a bad gouge, and it ended up hurting both of his tonsils. The gouge was so deep that it flowed blood all over the place, and Dr. Hemingway was there to stanch the blood flow, thankfully. But according to Lester Hemingway, whenever he was growing up, whenever he was doing something that wasn't very careful, especially when he was carrying things, they would say, "Hey, remember what happened to Ernest. You be careful." Now, the last element was about the concussion. He said he had a concussion and he still had trouble sleeping, insomnia. Well, he had insomnia well before the war. This was a condition that he inherited as part of what I would call his hypomanic personality. And hypomanic people have this unusually great attention to detail for short periods of time. They're somewhat bipolar in that they can be euphoric at one moment and be depressed another. They have real keen senses of facts, and Ernest memorized so many flowers and flora and fauna as a boy that he amazed his classmates and his friends and his parents. He had a great memory, so he didn't have insomnia as a result of the war. He inherited it. So many scholars and biographers believe Hemingway had a concussion, and that this mortar blast in 1918 contributed to shell shock, or what we now call post-traumatic stress syndrome. This belief in Ernest's self-proclaimed concussion led many, many people to believe that it was the so-called wound theory that drove his career to stratospheric heights. It's these wounds, they say, the psychological and physical wounds, were the driving force behind his literary greatness. I say, blaha. But there is no evidence that Hemingway suffered from any post-traumatic stress syndrome. In fact, Agnes von Karowski said he was a happy guy in the hospital. Henry Villard said he was a popular man in the hospital, encouraging his friends to come in and share a drink with him that he had his nurse friends sneak in for him. And of course, his friend Ted Brumback's letter reported the concussion of the explosion knocked him unconscious. Well, that letter came on July, I believe it was 14. It was over a week after Hemingway was injured. And the Red Cross and in Ernest's first reports in his cable back to his parents said nothing about being hit in the head, nothing about being knocked unconscious, nothing about taking bullet wounds. All he said was hit by mortar, injured minorly, should be walking again in 10 days or in about 2 weeks. The Red Cross reported that the mortar fragments had all been minor except for 10 fairly serious wounds. And of course, we know that two of those were a mortar shell in his big toe and a mortar shell behind his right patella of the knee, neither of which hit bone. Now, I've had some dialogue with some of the professors and some of the erudite people that belong to the Hemingway Society listserv, and one of the more interesting replies I got to my queries about this was from a researcher who is an outstanding researcher, an outstanding writer. And this person says, "I admire all your digging into the Fasalta injuries. I have no argument with the aluminum kneecap story and the details of the heart problem or the throat injury. As for the concussion and PTSD, though, you and I will have to agree to disagree. The long list of scholars that uphold the concussion at Fasalta and my own work is more persuasive to me than the opinions of the scholars who are in the minority, which include Kenneth Lynn and Frederick Cruz. If Hemingway was rendered unconscious in the trench at Fasalta, isn't a concussion of at least some severity a logical result?" I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to go, no. She quotes Farah as being one of the researchers who concludes this. Well, Farah and all the other researchers are relying on the details provided by Hemingway himself, first to Ted Brumback, and then in his ever-so-growing fantastical stories to his parents. If four of the facts, as Hemingway portrayed them to Owen Wister, if we know that three of them are blatantly false, why can't we conclude that the fourth one is? Logic would dictate that Hemingway was just blowing smoke again, and that we shouldn't be surprised that having a concussion at Fasalta lent his fantastic story more credibility when he said he carried a wounded Italian soldier the length of a football field on injured legs with mortar shell and now later machine gun bullets in his legs. Nah, didn't happen. And I show this in my book. I hope you'll tune into my book. It's called Hemingway, New Perspectives, New Inspiration. Should be out sometime later in 2022. Thank you so much for listening to this audio video broadcast. And I hope to see you down the road. Au revoir and à bientôt.